Hey guys, sorry about the slight delay, but welcome to episode 2 of Ask Mo. So I want to take a minute to thank you guys for tuning in again after last week's episode was such a huge hit. It was my very first one. I just want to take a moment to say thank you so much for coming back again and keeping the discussion going about natural hair and just about the benefits of it all together. So thank you again. And like last week, if you have questions, you can send those in either through the chat on Facebook. You can send it in through the chat on Google Hangouts, or if you're watching it live through YouTube, sorry about that. You can send it there as well. So I have all of those open so I can answer your questions live and we can jump right into it. So happy Wednesday, first off. Just to let you know that I will be doing this series again 2 weeks from now. So I'm going to have a 2-week schedule, broadcasting schedule. Every 2 weeks I'll come with a different aspect or a different episode that we'll talk about. A lot of the feedback will come from you. Hi, Kat. And then some of the topics will come from things that I think we should definitely talk about that I've had in individual conversations with each of you at different times. So tonight's episode, we are going to talk about this question that always comes up. So it's always, I'm natural, now what? So if you recall last week, I talked a little bit about my natural hair journey and how I went about my process. But I want to look at it from your perspective. I want to give you some advice on how you should go about your natural hair journey and things to consider. You know, these were definitely lessons learned from me, and I just want to share the knowledge with you. So let's jump into it and get started. So I'm going to backtrack a little bit to last week's episode where I told you I called my best friend Kanetta and told her to come over and just cut my hair off. I had transitioned for about 7 months and I was getting frustrated with the two different textures on my hair. You know, it was getting much more difficult to blend the two textures. I couldn't quite figure out how to style it. It was frustrating altogether. So I was at my wit's end. I said, forget about transitioning for a year or longer. It's just not gonna work for me. So I said, Kanetta, cut it off. And if you go to my very, very first blog post over on naturalandfab.com, you will see the picture of my hair. It was about this long. I thought I actually had much more length than that, but apparently I didn't. And I loved it for about 5 minutes. And then I was like, oh my God, what did I just do? Why did I do this? And then Kanetta said, oh, well, let's go out. Let's go to a shoe store. And I was so self-conscious and felt so uncomfortable because I said, oh my God, all my hair is gone. What was I thinking? Why did I do this? You know, it was another one of my great ideas that probably it worked out for the good. But at that time, I wasn't sure. So fast forward, here we are almost 7 years later. And I'm feeling much more confident about my hair. But what I didn't know at that time that I know now is that I was natural. Now what? What was I supposed to do next? You know, how was I supposed to know what products to use? How was I know who to talk to? You know, because then going natural at that time wasn't as popular as it is now. And I don't necessarily think it's totally trendy. But I do think it's part trendy and then part we're trying to eliminate a lot of these chemicals and things that and products that we use that are harmful to us in the long haul. So I did not necessarily have the clearest picture on how to move forward, but I did have a lot of friends who were natural who gave me a lot of advice from their perspective. I found a lot of resources online, which back then there really weren't a whole lot of them. And I just spent some time doing research. So the first thing I would say you need to do is, what's your why? Why are you going natural? You know, are you going natural for health reasons? Are you going natural for trendy reasons? You know, what is your why? You really need to answer that question because that will help you determine how you move forward. And it'll also give you a sense of peace and self-confidence. You know, this hair on our head is just hair. It's just here. If you took it all away, it wouldn't change who we are as a person. And people lose sight of that sometimes. So if you wear it, don't let your hair define who you are. Let it be an accessory. You know, it's a very pretty accessory, but let it be an accessory nonetheless. Let it be that thing that, you know, if one day you feel like having it hang down to the floor, do it. One day you feel like making it blue, do it. You can change it up with your mood. I do the same thing with my laptop covers. My husband is always asking me, why do you have a different case or a different cover? Because it's an accessory to me. Sometimes I'm in a purple mood, sometimes I'm in a pink mood. It just depends. So find your why. Find that reason for why you are doing this so that you don't lose sight of that. Because that will translate into confidence for you. You know, you can walk into a room with absolutely no hair to hide behind, and you will be the most confident person in the room. But this hair, this crown that we have, you know, we need to treat it well, but you need to know why you are treating it the way that you do. So my first step for you in your, you know, I'm natural now what process and journey is find your why. What's your why? And then once you know why, you can move into step two, which is a plan of action. And I'll have all these notes as well as a blog post for you guys following up, just as a side note. And I'll also post some on my Facebook page too. So step two, plan of action. You got your why, you know why you're doing it. Now you need to get to work. You need to figure out how are you going to go about this natural hair journey. So there are a couple things that people do when they decide to go natural. They will either do a long-term transition, which is you transition for a long time, and that's just a matter of growing out your permed hair or your pressed hair. Sometimes a long-term transition can be a year. For some people, it's longer than that. For some people, it's a couple of months. You can do a short-term transition, same concept and process. It can either be, you know, a few weeks, a few months, but it usually doesn't go into the whole year mark. That's more long-term. Or you can do what we call a big chop. And that is exactly how it sounds. You chop it all off. You cut your hair, cut off all the permed or straightened parts of your hair down until you get to the natural part, which is grown up. Typically, we call this the nappy hair, but it's not nappy. It's just your natural texture. So you would cut it off to there. I did a long-term transition, which was 7 months. And then I big chopped around my 7th month and just let it grow out from there. In hindsight, I probably wish I had held on about 3 more months so I could have had a little bit more length on the new growth. But at the same time, I'm kind of glad I went ahead and did it and just liberated myself in a sense and just pushed myself forward. I mean, remember, this was my 2nd time going natural, not my 1st. So now that you have this plan of action with the either long-term, short-term, or you just big chop, you know, what are you going to do for your long-term transition? Now, when you big chop, it's kind of easy. You can start finding products and doing everything else with it. If you do a short-term transition, same thing. But those people who transition for a long time, it becomes a battle of the wills for you. You have to figure out how to tame your hair and also how to tame your expectations of your hair. Just because you decided to go natural today does not mean your hair is going to look like mine tomorrow. It's just not. This is 7 years of almost 7 years of growth right here. And I've actually cut my hair several times. And you know, you have to be patient with your hair growing out. The most important thing is having healthy hair. You know, don't try to force it. Everyone's hair grows different. It has different textures. So you really need to take that into consideration and keep it in the back of your mind. You know, don't let it completely drive you crazy, but keep it in the back of your mind throughout your process so that you have realistic expectations. For some people, when they long-term transition, they'll do styles that blend the two textures together. So a couple of things you can do are braids. The first time I went natural, I kept my hair in different braid styles for exactly a year. I had micros, box braids, cornrows, you name it. And it was just a good way for me to grow it out without feeling self-conscious about myself, and so that I wouldn't have to look at those two different textures. And it did really well. I have actually very strong hair, so it can take a lot of styling. And this is also before I realized how gentle we need to be with our hair too. So braids worked out well for me. It may work out well for you. You can either use, you know, weave in your hair for the braids, or you can braid your own hair. Totally up to you. You can do braid out styles, which is basically what my hair is. Today is a braid out that went wrong. But it worked for me. So I'm just going to rock it and embrace it. Another thing you can do are roller sets. Roller sets are another really great way of blending those two textures. Last week I showed you the little perm rods. I used to do a lot of rodded sets while I was transitioning the second time because I found that it blended the two textures well. I would just wash my hair as I normally do, detangle it, and put the perm rods in, and that style could last me up to a week at a time. You know, both of those are good because the biggest thing with transitioning is finding a way to blend those two textures of your hair so that it doesn't look messy or all over the place. And braid outs are good because they're wavy and kinky, just like what's growing out of your head will be along with the permed hair. And roller sets are good because it keeps it kind of curly, and it's a hairstyle you can stretch out for a long period of time. So those are a couple of things that you can do there. And then you want to add, after you figured out how you're going to do your styling and you've developed this plan of action, you want to figure out, you know, product-wise, what's going to be your action and your way of determining which products to use. And we'll get a little bit more into products here a little later. But, you know, figure out how you're going to style your hair, because I'm telling you, it can be frustrating, exciting, and everything else in between. So I'm going to stop for a second before I go into step three and just see if there are any questions from anybody out there. You can feel free to send them to me on my Facebook Messenger. You can email them to me at naturalandfab@gmail.com, or you can just post it on the Facebook wall and I'll get it there too. So I'd love to hear from you. And if you have any questions, I got a question the other week from somebody talking about protein and, you know, how important is protein? Why do we need it? What does it do? And I actually think I'm going to dedicate a separate video to talking about protein, because I think it's really, really important to understand, you know, what protein is, one, but two, how does it play in relation to your hair? Because you can't just slap some protein on it and it's good. You know, protein, it's a balancing act with that, just like with anything else. So I'm going to do a separate video on protein. And if you did not see it earlier today on my page, I took a trip to Target because I needed to get some shea butter, some whipped shea pudding, and some leave-in conditioner. And Target was having a really, really great sale on all of their natural hair products. So I did a little quick video, and you can hear my kids in the background talking, and the baby. And I showed you some Shea Moisture stuff, a couple other products over there that look really, really interesting. And one thing that I'm noticing more between Target and Walmart are all of the trial size of products. So you're talking about Carol's Daughter, Shea Moisture, Mixed Chicks, and there was another one that was there too. They have these little 3-ounce bottles of products that are running anywhere from $3 to $2 if they're on sale, that you can get. And it's a great way to test out products without breaking the bank. I mean, you figure you go in with $10 and you get you a shampoo, a conditioner, and a leave-in, you're pretty good to go. So I would definitely check them out. Target has all of the lines on sale this week. Some of them are a little bit more of a sale than others. Some of them you can get $1 off. Some of them you can get some, you know, a couple cents off. But it's definitely worth checking out. So if you look on my Facebook page, I have a couple videos up there that I showed of a Target over in my area that you can check out. And you can also see if they're online on sale online too. So Kat, I see your question about protein, and we will definitely talk about that another episode. I will not forget. So I'm going to go back now into step three of this I'm natural, now what process. So we said we've defined your why. Why are you going natural? You know, we've defined your plan of action. How are you going to go about your natural process? Are you going to be a long-term transitioner, short-term, or are you just going to cut it all off? You know, so the third step in this is finding resources. What are the resources? Now, when I went natural, which seems like many, many moons ago, there weren't as many resources out there now. I mean, now I can turn to the left and turn to the right and there's, you know, five or six natural hair bloggers next to me, or there's a new natural hair site. Back in the day, and I hate saying back in the day, because it seems so, so far and so long ago, but back in the day, there really weren't that many natural hair resources out there. It was a very, very small niche community. So you would have to do a lot of digging, a lot of word of mouth, a lot of asking people, and just stopping people to ask questions. I would stop people in health food stores. I was lucky to have quite a few colleagues around me that were natural that just advised me on their own process and gave me recommendations and suggestions, you know, things that I didn't have before that, you know, I'm so glad that I did because it was extremely helpful and informative. But nowadays, the market is vast. You know, you can Google anybody. And anything, if you want to know how to do a braid out, there's probably 15 million videos on how to do a braid out. You know, if you're not sure about the different hair types, if you're a 4B as opposed to a 3C, there's 50 million videos out there for it. And I have probably seen all 50 million of them. And I found the ones that I liked and that worked for me. And I encourage the same thing for you. Find you some natural hair resources. You know, find you a couple forums or discussion groups to join where you can talk to other people who may be in the same stage or texture as you. You can find people where you can ask questions and bounce ideas off of. Find more product reviews. Natural and Fab was actually birthed out of this idea. Because I could not find the resources that I wanted and that I needed, I said, well, why don't I become a resource? Why don't I create my own site where I can talk to people who, like me, are newly natural and don't have a clue? You know, I need to figure out which sort of shampoo I should try. Why would I do one over the other? You know, what's the problem with silicones? You know, those sort of things. I couldn't find easy answers to them, so I had to figure it out on my own. And I took that information and just documented it on Natural and Fab. And that's where the idea came from. It was supposed to have been a personal journal, and it grew into an informational blog. And I have loved every moment of it, and I appreciate you guys for loving it too and supporting it for all this time. So thank you, and I encourage you to keep checking back at naturalandfab.com, because we have grown quite a bit. You know, I went from having hair that was about 2 to 3 inches long to now having almost waist length hair. And my focus and my audience were the newly natural, and now that I'm a little bit further along with my journey, I'm not forgetting about the newly natural, because I remember being in that place and I know how it felt. And I want to make sure that they have a voice here too, and they have the information that they need. So some of the different resources that I have found over the years that I've turned to have been so extensive. I am subscribed to quite a few people on YouTube, and I trimmed my list back down a few years ago to just the core people, because at that time, those were the people that had a couple of things similar to me. They either had the same hair texture, they were in the same place in their journey as me, we often asked the same questions, or I just loved the innovativeness with their styling that they did on their channel. So Some of those resources are, and I'll list them out here, and then I'll also list them on the blog and Facebook, Curly Nikki. Everybody knows about Curly Nikki. Curly Nikki was one of my favorite resources when I first went natural, and she has such an interesting story on how her whole journey came to be, because she's actually a psychiatrist or psychologist, and here she is, this natural hair blogger too, and I've seen her journey, you know, and I've been there from the beginning when Curly Nikki was this little bitty thing, and now it is huge. You know, she's considered an expert in this field. So curlynikki.com was definitely one of those resources that I loved. The other one that I loved was, you know, none other than my own Natural and Fab, because I felt, you know, I needed to be, I'm natural and I'm going to be fabulous with it. And I think we all should be, you know, no matter where we are. So, you know, the story of how Natural Fab came to be. So there was mine. The other one is Mahogany Curls. I absolutely love and adore her. She is such a sweetheart. I have been following her since she had a TWA. Now, if you do not know, a TWA is a teeny weeny afro. So that's typically when people have cut all their hair off basically down to the scalp and they have this little bitty afro. Mahogany Curls did that. And I remember watching her very, very first video when she had that TWA. And if you were to see her now, your jaw would drop. Her hair is absolutely gorgeous and beautiful, and she has such a great spirit about her. She's expanded where she talks a little bit about her family life and being a military wife, which I can totally relate because I was a military child, and just the products she uses. She's also an ambassador for Shea Moisture now too, which you guys know I have always loved and adored Shea Moisture since I was first turned on to them. So Mahogany Curls is another one, and I'll put a link to her information as well. The next person is Natural85. So you may have seen her on a couple of things. She is all over the place these days, I feel. Awesome girl. Another person I remember when she started her natural hair journey, and she was just this person documenting her journey, and it grew and expanded, and she's really become a lifestyle type blog. You know, she's definitely all about hair. She has some of the best natural hairstyles I have seen. And I wish I could say, and I'm sorry, I'm swallowing because I'm talking for a long time. I wish I could say they're overly complicated to do, and they are, but the way she teaches you to do it, it's not. And that, to me, can determine the success of a natural hair blogger. You know, how easy is it for somebody to follow along step by step to recreate the same hairstyle that you have? There are some natural hair bloggers, they'll come on the screen just like I am now, and then it'll flash and the hair is done. And I'm like, I don't even know how you did it. How did you do it? How did you get from point A to point B? That's what I need. I need the details in between. I need to know that sometimes if you braid from right to left instead of left to right, your hair won't curl. You know, those are the sort of things that I want to know, because I'm more about the in between and not necessarily the end to end. So, because of course the devil's in the details. So, Natural85 has, you know, this amazing mane of hair, and I love watching her videos to see what style is she going to be rocking now, because it's absolutely beautiful. I know between her and Mahogany Curls, their hair can take some serious time to just do in style. I mean, wash days are like massive for them. I couldn't even imagine just how much work goes into just washing their hair on wash day. That's crazy. And another channel and group that I loved was My Natural Sisters. So they are these three sisters. They are based out of Texas, I believe, and all three of them are natural. And it's funny because each had their own channel at one point, and then they kind of combine them together, and they each kind of tell their own story and do things together. And they are absolutely just
They're amazing women. They have such great spirits about them. They're mainstays and they're pretty popular at most of the natural hair shows. I know here in Atlanta, they're always at Talia Wajid's natural hair show that she has each spring. And I love these three sisters. Each of them are at a different point and stage in their natural hair journey. You know, there's one, I think she's big chopped at least 4 times now. And then there's the other who was doing more pressed styles, and then she decided to big chop and just kind of let her texture grow as well. And I love that you get these three different perspectives and three different stages of the natural hair journey, and you get to see how each has evolved and defined and redefined themselves and discovered new things about their hair. And they've also expanded into health and fitness as well, which is so, so important for natural hair. You know, your hair grows out of your body. So we want to be very mindful of what we're putting in our body because it is going to affect what comes out of it. So these three sisters, they're awesome. So check them out as well. My Natural Sisters. Again, I will post the links to their websites or to their YouTube channels for you guys to see some of the videos, but these are some of my favorites. There are many, many others out there, and I'll also add some of their links too, but you know, I'm not competing. I don't think we should make it about a competition. I think it should be about just loving your hair and loving you, and you know, you have to give love to be loved. So let's support, you know, the other sisters out here that are trying to do things and spread this word about natural hair and just being healthy overall. We have to do better with that. So let's summarize where we are now. We've talked about your why. We've talked about your plan of action. We found some resources, which are great. Let's talk about products. So how do you figure out what products you need to use during your natural hair journey? So I'm all about keeping it simple these days. When I started out with my natural hair journey the first time around, I was pregnant with my first son. So I had more time to play and explore and figure things out, but I also had my hair braided. So I didn't really need to figure out much at that time, other than when I took my braids out, I needed to wash, deep condition my hair, wait about a week before I got it braided again. That was good enough for me. The second time around, however, I've worn my hair out, and it has been trial and error from the beginning, and that is how it's going to be for you. I cannot tell you off the bat which shampoo is going to immediately work. I can't tell you off the bat which conditioner is immediately going to work, but I can tell you, you are going to need a couple of simple things to do this process and establish your process. The first one is a shampoo. Find you a good clarifying one and a good moisturizing two shampoo. The clarifying shampoo is going to help you cleanse your hair to clarify. It's going to strip it. Remember that it is going to strip it, so your hair will be extremely dry. You're also going to need your moisturizing shampoo. Now, this one is much more gentler. Think along the lines of baby shampoo. It's very, very gentle on your hair. So it's not going to strip it or clarify it as much as a clarifying shampoo, but it's still going to help cleanse. If you recall last week's note, I told you guys, when it comes to shampoo and conditioner, shampoo is for your scalp and conditioner is for your hair. So when you do your shampoo, you want to make sure when you put it on your hands, you're using the pads of your fingers, not your nails. But if you need to get in there and scrub, feel free to do so. And you want to massage your shampoo into your scalp because you want to get all that buildup, all that gunk off your scalp. You know, really work it in there and get all that stuff out. When you're rinsing it out, it's going to rinse through your strands. So your strands will, you know, get clarified and get cleaned as well. But if you want to rub a little bit on there, feel free to do so. So the clarifying is going to really open things up for you. On the times in between washes, when you don't use a clarifying shampoo, if you aren't co-washing, and I'll talk a little about co-washing, you want to use your moisturizing shampoo. That one is going to add moisture into your hair. sometimes your hair really just does not need to be as deeply cleaned. So you can use a moisturizing shampoo. There are many out there. Most of the ones that come from natural hair product lines, they tend to be moisturizing. If they're not, you can add a little oil to yours. You can even add a little bit of conditioner to it to add a little bit of moisture to it. And if all else fails and you don't want to use shampoo, use some apple cider vinegar. That's right. I said it. Apple cider vinegar. No, your hair will not smell like vinegar afterwards, which is a huge fear that I had too. But it's going to smell like it when you're cleaning it. And all you do is take a little bit of vinegar, mix it with some water, put in a spray bottle. You can finger part your hair in sections and then spray. And then you just work it in. And it is going to lift all that stuff up. And remember, apple cider vinegar has antifungal properties in it. So if you have dandruff issues, if you had a ringworm, you know, that will help alleviate that stuff. Don't be afraid of apple cider vinegar. It's great. So find you a good shampoo or go all natural with some straight up apple cider vinegar. It doesn't matter which brand, just make sure it's apple cider. You don't want to use white vinegar. It is not the same. It will not have the same effect on your hair. So get you a good shampoo. Next up, you want to get a conditioner. Now, conditioners are, they're not tricky, but they are. Because conditioners are going on the strands of your hair, they're going to add some weight to your hair. So you'll want to have a lighter conditioner for your summer months, where if you live in Georgia like me, we deal with the humidity here. And humidity can be a natural girl's either best friend or worst enemy. It just depends on how your hair is styled that particular week. Find you a very light conditioner, something that has great slip. And when we say slip, that means good for detangling. That can be Herbal Essence has a great one. You can also use Carol's Daughter. You can use Shea Moisture, whichever sort of shampoo conditioner you like, whichever line. You just wanna make sure you have one that's lighter so you can use during those lighter months, or those heavy hot months, so that they don't weigh your hair down. And then make sure you have you a heavier conditioner or a deep conditioner for the winter months, when we tend to wear hats and the air is drier and is pulling the moisture out of our hair. That deep conditioner or heavier conditioner will actually add moisture back in. So you wanna make sure you have those. If you are like me, where you only shampoo maybe once, twice a month at a time, because I suffer from really bad dandruff, so I have to be careful with over shampooing. But in the times that I don't shampoo, I do what is called co-wash, which is just short for conditioner wash. I only wash my hair with conditioner. Because it is summer, I have had to pull back on the co-washing. And when I do it, I use a very light conditioner, because with co-washing, that conditioner gets on your strands, it's gonna weigh it down. So once you start applying leave-ins and twisting creams and gels and everything else, it's just weighing your hair down. And you're not gonna get as much definition with your hair as you normally would if you didn't have it as clarified. So I tend to kind of alternate now with the summer, and with me working out more, I'm shampooing with each wash now. But I can tell at different times when I need to pull back on the shampoo and really concentrate more on the conditioner. So again, it's just one of those things, you just have to keep kind of playing with your portions to figure out, you know, which one works for you. But get you a really, really good shampoo conditioner. You don't have to spend a whole lot of money on it. You'll figure out which one works for you. There are a couple that I like to try that just seem to work, but just depends. Okay, so you got a shampoo, you got a conditioner. Now you need a good leave-in. So leave-in conditioners, I feel, they're one of two things that can either make or break your hair regimen. You know, we don't think about how important it is to have almost like a protectant on our hair. And that's really how I look at leave-in conditioner. It's like a protectant. The same way we use a heat protectant when we straighten it, leave-in conditioner is just your baseline protectant for your hair. So get you a good leave-in conditioner. Much like regular conditioner, You need you a light one for the summer and a heavier one for the winter. Because the light one in the summer, you know, you're fighting humidity, you're fighting heat, you don't want the weight on there. But you do want one that is going to add moisture to it. And y'all know how much I love my Kinky Curly Knot today. They are awesome. I've come to realize what I like in conditioners are more, are those that are more botanical based. So Kinky Curly Knot today, you know, all of the ingredients are all fruit extracts. They don't really have any fake ingredients in it. They're all fruit extracts, and it's like a gelatin. Darcy's Botanicals is another line that has awesome, awesome leave-in conditioners, but they're all botanicals. It's not all this, you know, laboratory concocted condition leave-in conditioners, you know, that that work. And there are many of them out here, and those are just two that I like, but find one that works for you. It can be, even if you leave a little bit of the regular conditioner in your hair, it's still conditioner. I actually just twist my hair with conditioner sometimes. If I don't have any more leave-in, I'll just get my conditioner and I'll use a little bit of that to twist. And my hair is moisturized, it looks great, it has great definition. It is the exact same thing without all the extra costs. So get you a good leave-in conditioner. Carol's Daughter makes a great one now. You guys remember from last week, I said I did not like Carol's Daughter when it first came out. It was horrible. And I'm sorry, Lisa, if you're hearing me say this about your line, but it was bad. And they finally went back and revamped the recipes for everything. And it is 10 times better. In my opinion, it is 10 times better. There's still some things where it just doesn't work for my hair, but it has improved much. And that Hair Milk leave-in conditioner has greatly improved. There's also the black vanilla one that works too. And with Hair Milk, you can either use it as a twisting cream or a leave-in. I think it's absolutely wonderful in the winter as a leave-in because it's creamy and it has some more weight to it. So it works really well for my hair during the winter months. My Kinky Curly Knot today, Darcy's Botanicals, those are great during the summer because they're very water-based and very watery. So it works. Excuse me. So we got your shampoo, we got your conditioner, we got your leave-in. Get you an oil. Now, the trick with oils, depending on your hair type, and we will do a video where we talk about hair type, depending on your hair type, you may need a heavier or lighter oil. And I say that because oils, for those of us with very thick, dense hair, excuse me, oils will either just lay on our hair, or if you're the type where it absorbs, it'll absorb well in your hair, actually be much more greasy. So you're gonna have to kind of play around with what's the best type of oil for you. You can never go wrong with argan oil. That's always a great starter oil. You can never go wrong with straight up olive oil. Sorry, my throat's getting dry. Pull it right out of your kitchen. Get you the extra virgin olive oil. Put it in there. Rub it in your hair. I love to do hot oil treatments where I'll warm the oil a little bit. Massage it in my hair. Wrap it up with a plastic bag, wrap that up with a towel, and then just let it sit for like 20-30 minutes. I very, very rarely ever get under a hair dryer. Oh, if you have a hair steamer, use the hair steamer. That would also be another great way to get that oil to help penetrate down into your hair cuticles as well. You know, that's always good. If you are the type where the oil kind of sits on it, you may want to do a quick rinse before you do anything else with it, or you do your hot oil treatment before you condition. Try not to be heavy-handed with the oil. It is, you know, heavy. So if you do add a little bit of oil to your conditioner, you probably don't need to do an oil treatment. Again, these are like tricks of the trade that you just kind of figure out as you go. So just play around with it and see what happens with it. But you want to make sure you get your oil. Some people like to make their own oil blends. Some people get extremely technical with it. I went through that whole phase where I was making my own hair butters and all that in the kitchen and whipping it up. And yeah, I got over it real quick because it became a time issue. But you know, if you are up to it and, you know, you want to make your own hair butter, you want to make your own flaxseed gel, do you. So oils, you can play around with them. Some people like to mix almond and macadamia nut and olive oil and apricot oil. And if you want to get that intricate with it, by all means, I like to keep it simple. So I will use olive oil, or I may use a little bit of coconut oil. And be careful with coconut oil because it's a protein, but we'll talk about proteins on another episode. So you have your shampoo, your conditioner, your leave-in, your oil. Now you need a cream. What are you going to twist your hair with or use to style your hair with? You want something creamy. You want something creamy because that is also going to add additional moisture. That's also going to help you with shine and definition. And it's also going to help seal everything in. That cream that you use to twist your hair with or style your hair with is the very last step in closing out your process. You know, so you want to find one that works for you. I started out using Shea Moisture Coconut Hibiscus Curl Milk. Still love the stuff. I use it on both my boys' hair. But as my hair has changed and evolved, I realized I can only use it in the summer or in the spring when there isn't as much humidity, because it works well for me then. It does not work well for me in the winter. It is way too light, and my hair needs as much added and extra moisture as it can get, because, I mean, that curl milk isn't going to do much of anything at all. So I try to make sure I have, you know, my heavy one around for any time, and then I have my light one around as well. Right now, I'm still twisting with my whipped shea pudding in the summer, and only because my hair is still going through this craziness where I feel like it's kind of changing again. And it seems like it needs a lot more moisture now in the summer. So it's a little strange, but I know how to adjust. And it's been doing well because my hair hasn't felt as dry or crunchy. And it looks pretty good. And, you know, like I said, this is a braid out that went bad. And it turned out actually very frizzy to me because I did not sleep with a bonnet or anything on my head the other night. And I was afraid it was going to be extremely dried out, but it's not. It actually came out okay. It's still not the way that I wanted it to be, but that's okay. Look, the best hairstyles are the ones that took the wrong turn, and it just works for you. So I'm using whipped pudding. You can use curl milk. You can use leave-in. Whatever you find, you know, if you want to use pink oil moisturizer, you can use that to twist your hair. Whatever you think works for your hair and your hair type, you know, try it and see how it goes for you. Just remain flexible and open-minded through all of this as you're going through this process. So we have your products down. You figured out whatever that regimen is going to be. And now, what are you going to do to capture this journey? Because this is a journey. This is a journey to your hair. This is a journey of self-discovery. This is a journey of, you know, self-improvement. There's so many things that come out of this hair journey. And I don't think we realize how much our hair affects us. And it can affect others. You know, our hair can actually intimidate people. And I've had to deal with that before, where it has intimidated people and people didn't understand it. And, you know, I've dealt with people wanting to touch my hair, which was so totally unwarranted, and I didn't ask for it, but I'm very protective of it. This is my crown. You can't just stick your hands in my hair. But I say all that to say, throughout this journey, you are going to want to look back. So whether you take pictures of your hair as you do it and post it on Instagram, post it on Facebook, you know, maybe you'll do like me, where you'll actually start a YouTube channel and a blog and just capture that, because I like to sometimes go back and look at all these old pictures of my hair and how far I've come, especially in those days I get frustrated with my hair and I'm not liking it. It was so necessary for me to do that after having this second baby, because I, like most women, was still dealing with, and I'm still dealing with, trying to feel comfortable in my own skin again. You know, you have a baby, things change, and you have to learn to love you no matter what. And my hair, you know, I told you guys I had problems with postpartum shedding. It was very, very bad for me. And I know some other mothers can relate to that, where I started losing my hairline about 6-7 months postpartum. It was the strangest thing to me. And it's still coming back, but it's significant. I think I showed you guys before. But, it, you know, it's significantly filled back in. And, you know, I wanted to be reminded of the fact that this was only temporary. It wasn't going to last forever. My hair was going to look great again. You know, my husband had no complaints about it. So, you know, as long as he was happy, I was happy. But, you know, I wasn't fully fulfilled. And I would sit and go back and look through my old pictures and say, oh man, yeah, you know what? It is going to come back. This isn't going to last. I remember when it was this long, I remember when it was this style, and I remember when it was this length, and I could do all these really funky, you know, great styles. And it's just good to also look at those pictures and be reminded of what place you were at in your life at that time too. You know, I remember looking at one of my pictures, and I didn't realize at the time that I took the picture that I was actually pregnant. And I remember that was the last picture I took before I found out I was pregnant. And that's always just this reminder to me of, you know, this point, this period in my life, a defining moment in my life, one of many that have happened. Same thing from when I got married, and I'll have to post a picture for you guys of my hair at my bridal shower. I was going through old photos the other night and came across this picture, and it was just all these pictures from my bridal shower, which was absolutely awesome. And it actually fell on my birthday that year. And I remember looking at my hair and I was like, God, my hair looked good. Yeah, like it looked really, really good. And I will never forget that, because that was my hair during the time, you know, a month or two before I got married. And that was another defining moment in my life. And so you'll want to document. You'll want to capture those moments that you can look back and say, yeah, you know what? I have come a long way. So when you do get frustrated with your hair, you can say, okay, I can hang in there for the long haul. Just, you know, this is a passing storm. It's going to get better. So, yeah. And, you know, and you may not want to document, and that's fine, too. It's totally, totally up to you, whatever you're comfortable with. But if you can, you should. I really think you should. So the last step in all of this, after you've done all these things, and so let's do a brief recap of what we did. We defined our why. We came up with a plan of action. We found us some resources to check out. We figured out our products. We documented this hair journey. And now the last step in all of this is to just enjoy your hair. You know, enjoy this accessory that you have. Play in it. You know, talk to others about it. See if there are other people that are going through the same journey as you, and see if they're interested in doing it too, and you guys can go through it together. Talk to people on these online sites and these forums and discussion groups. I mean, I love doing that. I started a series on Natural and Fab where I would interview people, and I actually want to start that back up now, where I would interview them about their hair. And I loved doing that, because you never really know why somebody did it, what sort of challenges they encounter. And I've met some amazing women that through my Natural and Fab blog and by interviewing them. There was one interview I'll never forget, and I don't even know if Colleen is even watching this, but Colleen, I knew her through Twitter, and I just always loved her. You know, she was no holds barred, just this awesome, awesome woman. And she had three kids, she was a single mom, and she was just doing her thing. But I wanted to interview her in her journey because she has two boys and a daughter, and her kids are biracial. And I know there are so many women out there that have biracial kids, whether the mother is black and the father is white or vice versa. And they're not really sure what to do with their hair, what products to try. And I was always curious to know, you know, how she handled her daughter's hair and what she found out works for her. But then also, what did she say and talk to her daughter about her hair? Because I have biracial friends, and I remember growing up, a lot of people weren't always so nice. Because the hair texture was very different. And I just wanted to know that. And Colleen has always been one of those people that I will never, I'll never forget her. And, you know, we're still really good friends online, and we follow each other on Instagram and Twitter. And her daughter is just growing up into this beautiful young lady. And I know a lot of that has been all of the love and positivity Colleen has poured into her, not from just being a biracial child, but from just being a young woman in today's world. So, Colleen, if you're watching, you know, I've never forgotten you. And, you know, love you to death. So, yeah, I want you guys to just enjoy this hair that you have, this crown that you have. Talk to your daughters about your hair, about their hair. Let them know that their hair is beautiful no matter what. You know, people may pick at it or call it nappy. Maybe their hair doesn't grow as long as other people's hair does. I think all little girls have encountered that at some point and, you know, wanted this long, silky blonde hair and other stuff. But, you know, at the same time, we need to pour that positivity into our girls and tell them, hey, your hair is beautiful no matter what. You know, and embrace those kinks and those curls because your confidence comes from within. So I'm not going to make this about a whole self-confidence preachy thing, but, you know, I know the struggle that has come with hair, and even the envy that comes with it. There are people that can be envious of your hair. You know, they may want to know, well, why is your hair that long? And I've heard everything from, oh, you must be mixed with something. I've had people swear up and down I've had weave in my hair. Of course, you deal with the name calling. It all happens. It's all going to happen. But at the end of the day, as long as you know who you are, and our daughters know who they are, and even our sons, because both my sons have a lot of hair, that's all that matters. So you embrace those crowns of your hair and tell your daughters to do the same too. So I am going to wrap up here. I want to thank you guys for joining me on this episode of Ask Mo. So I'll be back in 2 weeks where I'm going to do another episode. I may actually do a live tutorial of my process. I haven't quite decided on the topic, but if you guys have a topic you would love for me to do, please message it to me, post it on the Facebook wall. Please have discussions about hair on the Facebook wall. I will keep doing some of these little live videos when I'm out and about. I may even do a quick video on my boys' hair when I wash their hair, because wash day around here includes all three of our hair heads. So, it's always a feat around here. So God forbid the day I have a daughter, I mean, it's going to be madness with all this hair around here. But I welcome any topics. I'm going to keep posting info. Make sure you're checking out my blog. I am on Snapchat. I am actually creating a separate Snapchat for Natural and Fab, because I do have one that's like a personal one too, but I want one where I can just solely dedicate it to the natural hair stuff. So bear with me on that one. You can follow me on Instagram. I'm there. My name is Naturally1908. And I'm also on Twitter as Naturally1908. I don't tweet as much as I should, but, you know, I'm trying to get back into it. It's just, it's busy. It's busy. So thank you guys. Spread the word about Ask Mo. You know, tell people to check it out and check me out. And I just appreciate all of your support and your questions. And I will see and talk to you soon. Bye.